Thank you. Shall we do Jedwabh and Hynny? Jedcut.
Thank you. Okay, you ready to start? Okay.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to JW3. My name is Miriam Zahava. I'm part of the programming team here at JW3, and I will be your host for this evening, marking the departure and expulsion of Jews from the Arab countries and Iran. This event is especially close to my heart, as I myself am a Mizrahi and Iraqi Jew. My family were living in Iraq for centuries, and although we left a little earlier than most of our speakers here tonight, we share many similar stories, traditions, and sadly, struggles. I would like to dedicate my contributions towards this event to my two great-great-grandmothers, Lulu and Gaji, both Iraqi immigrants to India, both strong women dedicated to their community and deeply connected with their Jewish identity. Okay. Their legacy continues to be felt through the generations of my family, as well as the communities they were so devotedly served. I would also like to take a moment to honor their granddaughter, Telma, my wonderful Safta, watching now from Nachlaot, Jerusalem. Hi, Safta. Thank you, Safta, for teaching me more about my beautiful heritage and educating and inspiring me to share the stories of my Iraqi family and the world they left behind. I'm grateful that tonight we will be hearing more of their history of that extraordinary community. And now I would like to invite JW3's Director of Programming, William Galinsky, to the stage to officially open tonight's event.
Thank you, Miriam Zahava. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of JW3, I want to welcome you, everyone who's here tonight and everyone who's online watching the event. In partnership with Harif, the UK Association of Jews from the Middle East and North Africa, Sephardi Voices UK, and the S&P Sephardi community, JW3 is very honoured to once again be hosting the official UK commemoration to mark the departure and expulsion of more than 850,000 Jews from Arab countries in Iran in the 20th century. We're delighted to be joined tonight and hear words from representatives from each of our partner organisations alongside of those of other community leaders. In addition, we'll be screening an illuminating film created by Sephardi Voices. If this is your first time connecting with JW3, we are the Jewish Community Centre in London that's open to all. We strive to raise the volume and variety and quality of Jewish conversation in London and beyond. Tonight's events reflect both this and our ongoing commitment to create inclusive programming that highlights and celebrates the rich diversity of our Jewish community. Tonight's event explores the story of the last Jews of Iraq and those who became hostages to a regime of terror under Saddam Hussein and witnessed the Baghdad hangings of 9 innocent Jews in January 1969. We'll be hearing the story of Jack Hikmet in conversation with Sharon Theodore. It's now my pleasure to introduce our wonderful community partner and co-founder of Harif, Lynn Julius, to share more about the significance of this day.
Well, thank you very much, William, and thank you, Miriam Zahava. It's been a great pleasure to have worked with you to put on this event. In fact, this is the fourth time that JW3 has partnered with Harif to host our annual 30th of November UK commemoration. Long may our successful partnership continue. So good evening to everyone here, and good evening, bonsoir, erev tov, to all those watching us online. I'm delighted to be representing Harif, the UK Association of Jews from the Middle East and North Africa. Harif exists to raise awareness of the history and heritage of these Jews. And this is the eighth year we have held an event to commemorate the departure and exodus of Jews from Arab countries and Iran. First of all, I would like to thank my Harif colleagues, all volunteers, Michelle Huberman, Ralph Assor, Sandra Dangour, Kim Cohen, and Lawrence Julius. Apart from JW3, I'd like to thank our partners, Sephardi Voices UK and the S&P Sephardi community, and our distinguished guests here tonight. S&P Sephardi Rabbi, Senior Rabbi Joseph Dweck, Michael Wieger, representing the Board of Deputies of British Jews, Michelle Janes of the Jewish Leadership Council, Gary Mond of the National Jewish Assembly, and Efrat Perry, who is here with her diplomatic colleagues from the Israeli Embassy. Welcome all. Why is the 30th of November so significant? This is the date designated by Knesset law symbolically to recall the persecution and riots which broke out against Jews in Arab countries on the day after the 1947 partition plan for Palestine was passed by the UN. And this triggered the Jewish exodus. In a generation and a half, almost all the ancient pre-Islamic Jewish communities of the Middle East and North Africa have become extinct. From almost a million Jews in 1948, only 4,000 remain, and that number dwindles year by year. Middle Eastern and North African Jews were the largest group of non-Muslim refugees until the exodus of Christians from Iraq in 2003. There are no Jews in Libya, no Jews in Algeria, 3 Jews in Syria, 3 Jews in Iraq. To quote the writer Edwin Black, we speak of a largely forgotten ethnic cleansing, largely unparalleled in the history of humanitarian abuses. This year is the 55th anniversary of the Six-Day War. So we decided to focus on the repercussions on the This year is the 5th anniversary of the Six-Day War. So we decided to focus on the repercussions on the few thousand Jews still remaining in Arab countries. In 1967, all these communities were quietly going about their business. But the vindictive Arab reaction to Israel's victory changed all that. Jews in Libya and Aden were taunted by enraged mobs. They were evacuated for their own safety. In Sudan, Morocco, and Tunisia, there were demonstrations and anti-Jewish riots. Almost the entire male Jewish population of Egypt was paraded as Israeli prisoners of war. They were arrested and imprisoned, some for as long as 3 years. But our specific focus today, however, is on the Jews of Iraq. Jews became hostages to a regime of terror, as William mentioned, under Saddam Hussein. There were the hangings in January 1969, which sent shockwaves through the community. And eventually, desperate Jews escaped from Iraq in a daring smuggling operation through Kurdistan until the government allowed the remainder to leave with passports. Now, this story affected my own family. My aunt Marcel, who was a widow, was settled in London with her 3 children, but she went back to Iraq just to sell some property. She thought it would take just a few weeks or a month, but she ended up trapped for 6 years, and my parents had to take care of her children. during her absence. She and my cousin Lisette were among those who were smuggled out by the Kurds. So these Jews were the last Jews of the Arab world. They were not Zionists. If they had been, they would have left long before. To the regimes that persecuted them, it made no difference. They were persecuted because they were Jews. That's an important lesson to those who would distinguish between anti-Semitism and anti-Zionism. In spite of all the suffering and trauma, it's important to emphasize that the Exodus was a blessing. Jews found refuge in freedom-loving countries, in Israel and the West, and rebuilt their lives successfully. No Jew wants to return, but they do want their displacement and dispossession to be recognized. They want their place in history and memory. In January this year, David Dangour, who we are honored to have with us tonight, commissioned a poll in Israel. There, a majority of the Jewish population hails from Arab and Muslim countries. The poll found that 3/4 of Israelis never learned anything at school about Mizrahi history and heritage. 14% had never heard of the Farhud in Iraq, the pogrom in which 179 Jews were murdered in 1941. 89% of respondents had never heard of the 30th of November commemoration. If Israelis are that ignorant, how much more ignorant must Jews be in the majority Ashkenazi diaspora? Jewish institutions in the UK, the BOD, the JLC, the NJA, can make a difference. All are committed to diversity. But that does not just mean promoting exotic food or colourful folklore. Every Jewish school should include the history and heritage of Mizrahi Jews in their curriculum. This does not mean idealizing relations between Muslims and Jews. We need to state clearly, without distortion or obfuscation, that the Jews came as refugees from Arab countries. They were fleeing anti-Semitism. It is bad enough that in this country, anti-Semitism is largely ignored. It's not taken seriously or it's downplayed. Jews don't count. And unfortunately, Mizrahi and Sephardi Jews count even less. That's why we need to keep telling their story and integrate it into the story of the Jewish people as a whole. So tonight we are very excited to be showing a film we have commissioned from Sephardi Voices UK on the last Jews of Iraq. And I wish to congratulate Daisy Aboudi on producing an excellent and powerful piece. Here to introduce the film is Dr. Bea Lefkovich, director of Sephardi Voices UK. She is an oral historian and social anthropologist, and she's the co-founder and director of 2 oral history archives, AJR Refugee Voices and Sephardi Voices UK. She has conducted more than 250 interviews, and amongst her publications are The Jewish Community of Salonika, History, Memory and Identity, and a collection of interviews entitled Emigre Voices. Bea.
Thank you, Lynn. Rabbi Dweck, ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor to address you tonight when we're commemorating the departure and expulsion of Jews from Arab countries and Iran, with particular reference to the fate of the last Jews in Iraq. This is an important evening in our calendar as still so little is known about the Jews who remained in Iraq after 1951 and who suffered from discrimination, exclusion, and intimidation over many decades. When we created Sephardi Voices UK in 2009, our aim was to capture these experiences, preserve and disseminate them as widely as possible. In fact, the first interviews I carried out for Sephardi Voices UK were all with Iraqi Jews who had left Iraq in the 70s, Abdallah Dangour, his sister Aline Khalasci, Aida Hakim, and Jacqueline Khalasci. And Aline and Jacqueline will appear in the film we're going to show you tonight. I believe that it is due to the power of their testimony that we were able to carry on our work and which enabled us to capture the 120 interviews in our collection today. When I visited the Museum of Babylonian Jewry in Or Yehuda in Israel last summer for the first time, I was incredibly moved to see the history of Iraqi Jews narrated in a museum, especially when I entered the room dealing with the Fahud and the persecution of Jews in the late 60s and 70s, which includes a long list of names of the men and women hanged, murdered, and missing. As long as there is an absence of this history in other museal and educational spaces, the testimonies we have collected are our precious digital museum, which we have to nurture and develop for education. Please help us to integrate, and I would exactly support what Lynn said before, please help us to integrate these testimonies into our formal and informal Jewish education so that future generations will know the story of Sephardi Mizrahi Jews who left their homes and found refuge in the UK. I'd like to thank Daisy Aboudi, SVUK's Deputy Director, for putting these testimonies beautifully together. And as you will see in the film, these are memories of a difficult time for most interviewees. And I would personally like to thank Niran Basuntiman, Aileen and Jacqueline Khalasci, Nadia Nathan, who is here with us tonight, Edwin Shuker, Saba Subeda, and Carmen Hakam for entrusting us with their memories. I would also like to give a special thank you to Dalit Chaim, who is also here with us tonight, for reaching out to Sephardi Voices UK and giving us the testimony of her father, Said Khadun. Dalit did not know that in our last interview with Carmen, her father was mentioned because he was imprisoned together with Carmen's father, Moshe Hakam, on Pesach in 1969 for 4 months. So tonight we're privileged to watch these testimonies side by side and to listen to the recollections of some of the last Jews of Iraq.
know, this is going to sound really very strange to a lot of people. I had a beautiful childhood. Maybe because of our parents, they shielded us from all what's happening. Normal childhood, we went out, we went to trips, we were members in sort of a community club. We used to go swimming in this club in the summer from 10 o'clock in the morning till 10 o'clock in the evening. We had, it was like a family club, and we had friends, we had Christian friends, we had Muslim friends, and we used to go out on trips together, and everything was normal. We didn't, the first time I felt different was in 1967, I was 10.
So for the first 4 days, we really were kind of like it was a panic setting, you know, are they winning, are they losing? And we knew either way, we knew we're losers. I mean, you know, if Israel won, we'll be losers because they'll try and get the revenge on us. If Israel lost, we'll be losers because they'll come and say, ah, oh, you know, you are next after your brethren's in, Jewish brethren's in Israel.
After the 67 war, they cut our telephones. We had no telephones. All the Jews, no membership at the clubs, we couldn't get anywhere. So between us, it was really a difficult time, very difficult time.
We arrived to the university and there were buses, there were people going, you know, in when we have a feast or whatever, or henna, they go, whoa, 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 you know, of happiness. And they were giving out sweets to everybody, you know, like it's a very, very happy day. And I went into the girls' rooms and the girls were laughing and whatever, and they went to see the dead bodies and they dragged my friend, my Christian friend, with them. I could see she didn't want to go, but she was very, very scared. She had to go. So they went, and when they came back, it was very, very scary. They were, I couldn't imagine people from university can behave in such a savage way. They were really even imitating. Did you see this one, how his head was and whatever? So we went back home, and that was a black day.
Pesach of 1969, in the Chol HaMoed, which is the bit in the middle, in between the festivals, my father went to visit friends of his in their office. They were his clients as well, but they were friends. He did not work during the period. Anyway, we were on that day, we were at my grandmother's house, and the secretary came to my grandmother's house and wanted to see my mother. And she said to her, I'm sorry to tell you, they came, they. We did not need to know who they were, they. They came for the boys and they took them. The interesting thing about my father's imprisonment was he never talked about it. There was a testimony of one of the prisoners who was with my father. His name was Sa'id Hardoun.
They took me to prison, which is really not a prison. It's because the place they took us, it's not a prison belonging to government or to the army or any official body in the country. It belonged only to Saddam Hussein. We were three in this row, in this cell, 6 by 6 feet. We couldn't even sleep on our back. We used to sleep on our side because there is no space for three of us to sleep in this. Food was terrible. One time a day early in the morning, they used to take us to the bathrooms. The bathroom was full of human dirt. And they used to put us some bricks to walk on it because the dirt was so high. But the food was once a day. They used to bring rice and soup in a baguette. The rice, they used to serve it by their hands, bare hands. The reason they took us, we don't know. The reason they let us go, also we don't know. It's just to complete the play. The innocent will go out and the criminal, they hang him.
So there was absolutely, absolutely nothing to look for, but zero, except for running away. So we were expecting it, but you hope you never hear it. It's like a major operation. You just hope that it won't happen, but you know that it's in the offing. So one day he brought us back, and I remember the day very well. I remember the room very well when he asked us to come in. And, you know, with glum face, he said, we have 2 hours in this house and we will be gone.
We got to the north in the evening. It was pouring down with rain. The taxi driver stops the car in this village. And he said, right, you're here. Said, what do you mean we're here? It's dark. There's no light. There's nothing, you know. I don't know. I was told to give you here, to dump you here, to stop you getting out. Out of nowhere, out of the dark, this Peshmerga guy, Peshmerga are the Kurdish fighters, you know, heavily armed, and with a little, I think he had a torchlight. We could see something, you know, we could see also still pouring down. And he said, what are you guys doing here? And we said, well, you know, we are Jews, we are trying to escape, and we're told that this is here, somebody will meet us and will take us across the border. He said, there's nothing scheduled for tonight. You know, there's been no one coming through this way since September.
I just remember so clearly these moments that screams at me. I remember these guys when we stopped in checkpoints, and they would push this machine gun inside the for extra effect inside the car, and ask my father to get off the place. And my father would go out, and you can see him, how anxious he is. And we're sitting in the car, and the film plays in my mind, on and on and on, until we reached the Kurdish enclave.
He went out and he came back and he said, we can cross using mules, but I can only command 3 mules. So, my mother said, how do we do on 3 mules? There are 5 of us. So I said, look, we want to get out. We want to get across the border now. You 3 ladies go on the mules, so on the 3 mules, and Morris and I will walk. And about half an hour into this, bullets start to fly around. So we went on the floor in the mud, all 5 of us. And the 2 Peshmerga guys as well. And then they said, look, you know, I said, are we forward? No. We're going back.
We had a very rough ride because instead of being 9 people journey, we were now 22 in the same car. It's the same sort of pickup car for like a cattle we would pack there. And that was very, again, I remember the thoughts in my mind saying, I want to be back, I want to go home, I want to go home. I can't take that. I cannot take any more of this. I cannot look in the valley, and it's the valley of death. We were 20 people in the car, 22 people. We were packed one on top of the other. There was no lights. The cars had to drive completely in darkness. The valley is down there. no barriers, no nothing. You could see the odd lorry down in there. And I don't want, I cannot take any more of this. And I was so angry for being put into that position. Actually, we made it.
Well, this is the third night now. We are in this house. A jeep came in, and we all huddled in, all five of us. And the guy who was driving couldn't speak a word of Arabic. And we thanked the senior guy. You know, we thanked him for his hospitality and all that. And he said, you know, he wished us luck. And he said, don't forget us when you go out into the big wide world. And you know, we drove for about an hour and 15 minutes, an hour and a half, something like that. And you know, we got to this place where there was a little border, you know, a little barrier. And the guy got out, lifted the barrier, and drove through, and took us to the first village in Iran.
We had gone to the north of Iraq, as I was saying. We used to spend our summers there. And one day, we got a knock on the door, and it was the security service. They suggested we ought to pack up all our things and go with them, which we did. So we were taken in a van, as they put it, down to Erbil, to the police station. So when we arrived there, who should we see? Oh, so many Iraqi people, Jews, I should say. So many Jews, friends of the family, they were all taken. They were trying to escape, really and truly. We were the only family that were not trying to escape, but that doesn't matter. The next day, we were all driven in vans, whoever was in Erbil, in the police station, to Baghdad. And we were put in the hall of the Baha'is. So we were 136 people in this particular hall, where we spent 17 days, and we were finally released on the eve of Rosh Hashanah of 1970.
My father and my husband went to prison for 15 days as well, for no fault of their own. When we got our passports, my husband and my father went to take them. The officer in the passport office wanted some tips from them. But because my father always was a civil servant, he thought to give a big sum, it might be considered as a bribe. So he told my husband, you give 5, I will give 3 dinars. So, you know, it won't be considered as a bribe. Apparently, that officer was charging each Jewish person who got their passport about 30 to 50 dinars. The other, you know, police men in the passport office wanted to share with him his intakes. He said, what did I take? Only 3 dinars from Yusuf Khazoum and 5 dinars from Haroun Khalashi. So they took them in prison straight away.
We got our passports. I recall that we had to go to a place again to do with the Secret Service. We had to present ourselves, even us children. And somebody asked my mother what her father's name, and she was so frightened. She had to ask my father what her father's name was. She was so frightened she couldn't recall his name. Anyhow, we were given a passport. And we were told, as I think the case had happened with all the Jews that left at that time with a passport, if you do not come back within 3 months, we will confiscate all your assets. We flew to Beirut, just could not wait. But my mother did cry as the plane went round and there was like a little mound and the airport disappeared from sight. And she said, that is it. We have said goodbye to our country of our birth forever. Thank you.
Thank you so much to Sephardi Voices for producing that amazing, amazing video. I'd like to welcome Michael Wieger, the Chief Executive of the Board of Deputies, to the stage.
I somewhat feel that silence would be the best reaction for a couple of minutes after seeing such an extraordinary film, and I'm sure all of you will join me in really feeling that enormous set of appreciation to Sephardi Voices and to Harif and, of course, to JW3 for hosting us. It was a story I didn't know, and I did know all at once. My own heritage is Polish. My father is a survivor. I grew up on those stories. And so whilst I knew as a scholar of Jewish history, the facts behind much of what we heard just now, I, of course, with the exception of Edwin Shuker's story, which I did know, I did not know the rest of them. They were alien, and they were so familiar at one and the same time. They tell a story that has been a Jewish story for 2,000 years. And it makes me think about the ongoing challenge that we all have, all Jews around the world. How do we, at one and the same time, remember the difficult things that have happened to our people and yet not allow those to define us? Because our Judaism, our Jewish life, must be defined by our traditions, by our ritual, by our belonging, by a positive story we wish to impart. But I also acknowledge, on a day like this, it's a day to dwell on these stories. That is the importance of the 30th of November. We must absolutely dwell on those stories, hear them and honour them, and ensure, and I'm doing this on behalf of the Board of Deputies and our work at the Board, that we really do help our community to better understand all that happened to Jews from the Arab world and Iran, and to ensure that those stories are built into the fabric of what it means to be a British Jew, whatever your background, Ashkenazi, Sephardi, Mizrahi, Middle Eastern, Iranian, whatever it might be. So kol hakavod, congratulations to Harif, to Sephardi Voices, and may we continue to tell and be inspired and remember these stories for generations to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Can I please introduce Michelle Janes, the co-executive director of the JLC. Born in Australia to Iraqi and Egyptian parents, Michelle is proud of the rich heritage, history, and diversity. She is a qualified teacher and has worked professionally in the Jewish community for over 10 years. Her MBA thesis focused on the CEO-chair relationship in the charity sector. She is a governor of a primary school in Stevenage. She loves cooking, singing, and can often be found doing both.
I feel like I'm not sure what else I need to say. I'm really honoured to speak this evening on such an important moment in our communal calendar, one that has been championed by those in this room. I want to thank you, Lynn, and your supportive team at Harif, as well as Sephardi Voices UK, JW3, SNP Sephardi Community, and everyone involved in this occasion. Marking this moment may evoke a whole host of emotions for those in the room and watching online, and though sometimes challenging to deal with, we should not shy away from telling stories, sharing feelings, and hearing about the experiences of others. I'm proud to share a little of my story with you this evening as part of our reflections. And I say this with renewed urgency and poignance, having received news just this morning that my great uncle Edmond, whom I will share some of my reflections with, sadly passed away just this morning. May his memory be a blessing. On a small patio in a newly built home in 1936, the family sat with the father of the house, arak in hand, mother relaxed, and the children answering quiz questions. The winner of the quiz was always Bertha, my grandmother of blessed memory. She would be married in 1944 and move to what is now known as Mumbai. Friday night dinner consisted of kubba, rice and bamia, while the tabit was served up for Shabbat afternoon. I know this because my dear great-uncle Edmond painted the picture of his life growing up in Baghdad in his memoirs. A less pretty picture was the time he described being held for 3 months in jail, where he had been just feet from the gallows. Only after considerable money was spent on defending him were the trumped-up charges dropped. In September 1950, soon after their arrival in Israel, having escaped Iraq, my family were en route to a refugee camp. They were searching for some biscuits for my great auntie Rina, who had fell unwell during the journey. The shops were closed already because it was Erev Yom Kippur, and as Yom Kippur passed, the family queued for rations and found themselves having to survive on inedible vegetables and stale black bread. The tale is familiar to so many who have had to flee, leaving behind the comfort of what was once home. I once tried to make bamia for a home economics lesson at school. It didn't go well, and I have to admit it did put me off okra for life. But I find the way my family's memory is woven into the food we eat to be a powerful connection in my mind. The gatherings around the porch or kitchen table, which might have taken place in the Alexandria homes of my father's family or Baghdadi homes of my mother's family, homes which I can never visit, where the lives of generations of my family unfolded but would not look the same today. Homes just like mine, where my kitchen and dining table are the heart of our family. It's not the food, but it is important and delicious, but the collective experience, the hands that kneaded and spiced and sliced, the talk of life and love and hope and fears, the smells filling the air, the delicate pastry of the sambusak and the strips of kamradin eaten like sweets. Growing up, the Middle Eastern food of my family was at times seen as exotic by my friends. It was the food you got from another place, flavours from other lands. But now I don't make these foods because they are exotic. I make them because they are pieces of homes and lives that have been lost. Pieces of my family story that should not only live in books. I am proud to lead the JLC as co-CEO alongside Claudia Mendoza, who only last year shared her personal story at this commemoration. We know all too well how vital it is that we preserve these memories and the rich history of our journeys and experiences. It's why we must highlight the tragic circumstances of those who have been forced to leave their homes in generations past, celebrate the diversity of our community, and share the memories for generations to come.
Thank you so much, Michelle, for those words. I'd like to introduce Efrat Perry, our representative from the Israeli Embassy. She is the Director of Public Diplomacy.
Rabbi Dweck, Lynn, and Harif team, thank you for your work to organize this wonderful event. JW3 and the Sephardi Voices, it is a privilege to join you tonight. The story of the last Jews of Iraq and the stories of Jewish people from Arab lands and Iran, more broadly, is unquestionably the story of the State of Israel. I think of Dan Bar Moshe, a student from when Saddam Hussein rose to power, who, with the support of a Kurdish friend, helped to smuggle Jewish families through northern Iraq to Iran, when they were greeted by Israeli embassy there. Dan Bar Moshe fled the turbulence of Ba'athist regime for a new life in the Jewish homeland. Now living in Israel with his grandkids, his efforts to help the last Jews of Iraq to safety in Israel were recognized by our defense ministry. 600,000 of over 800,000 Jewish people who fled Arab lands in the last century similarly found sanctuary in Israel. The Jewish state, a singular beacon of refuge in a hostile region, Mizrahi and Sephardi Jews make up 50% of our population, undoubtedly shaping the rich tapestry of Israeli society. Their stories have influenced our culture, our major institutions, and have formed our personal as well as our national identity. We recognize that we can't share our story without emphasizing Israeli Mizrahi and Sephardic heritage. In 2014, the Knesset voted to officially mark the 30th of November as a day to commemorate the plight of Jewish refugees from Arab lands and Iran. I can attest that it is a priority for the Ministry of Foreign Affairs that the story of Jews from Arab lands and Iran is told widely. It is of the utmost importance that people understand we are a country built on the shoulders of brave Jewish refugees who were successful in creating a new life. The stories of the last Jews of Iraq, accounts we will hear from the panelists this evening, are a reminder us as to the why the Jewish homeland is essential to all of us. It is a privilege to join you to hear your story, a story familiar to many Israelis, and a story we hope more people will hear. Thank you.
Efrat. Some of you will remember Carol Isaac's motion comic, The Wolf of Baghdad, which was screened at the UK Jewish Film Festival at the Phoenix Cinema in November 2009, and then just before the first COVID lockdown in March 2020 here at JW3. The Wolf of Baghdad screening on both occasions was accompanied by live music. I'm just reading my pronunciations on this. Ayin, a seven-piece band who specialized performing the music of Jewish communities of the Middle East and North Africa. And some of you will remember in September last year, Ayin, in playing concert here at JW3, entitled Open the Gates of Mercy, featuring the internationally renowned Hazan David Raymond. We have two members of the Ayin band here tonight, John Banks on Kanun, and Keith Clausen on Oud, who are now going to play for you a short selection of popular Iraqi songs from the past. Thank you. These songs are Fog and Nakel. Sorry. please correct me. Che Mali Wali. There we go. Shems Ash Shemusa. I got that one kind of right, okay. Tal Amin Bait Abuha. There we go. You all know them. John and Keith will be playing instrumental versions of these songs, but if you know the words, as I'm fairly sure you will do, please feel free to sing along. Ladies and gentlemen, John Banks and Keith Glaston.
Sorry. Thank you so much to John and Keith. I'd like to introduce our panel to the stage. That is Lynn from Harif, Sharon Theodore, and Jack Hikmet.
Well, Sharon and Jack, thank you very much. Thank you very much for joining me. Can you hear me?
Yeah, maybe we should be. I think it's probably because we see each other.
Hello. Can you hear me? Good, good. Excellent. Well, thank you very much for joining me, Sharon and Jack. Now, you weren't in the film yourselves, but I know you were in Baghdad at the time. So I'd just like to ask you to share your memories of that time. I'm assuming you lived through the hangings. You're old enough to remember the hangings. Sharon, you go first.
I'll take yours. As they say in Hebrew, "Mashe batuach, batuach." This one is working. Can you hear me? The Jewish community, like I recognize, of course, everybody in the movie, and one of them is Nadia, who is sitting there. And the reason is because we all went to the same school, and we used to see each other. So even if we did not know each other directly, we knew about each other. So the story of one is really the story of all. And in January 1969, I think all, if not most of the Jews were exposed to what happened to every single person who spoke on the screen. And my family was also one of them. I remember in January 69, I was all alone at home. And there was a knock at the door. I opened the door, and there were three security men. And they say, "We came to search your house and take your eldest brother for interrogation." And of course, I opened the door for them, and they came in, and they started searching. And they were very rough. And then instinctively, I felt I should go and get them some water, some drink, so that they can cool down. And sure enough, they cooled down, and then they said to me, "Let chaf in ochti, don't be scared." And they continued searching. They filled up about 3, 4, 5 bags, stuff from the house, everything they could reach. And they waited because there was nobody at home. Then one of my brothers came in, and they said, "Okay, we are going to take this brother, and we'll come back in 3 hours. And hopefully in 3 hours, the person we came to look after, to look for, will be back, and then we can exchange the two." And they left with one of my brothers. And meanwhile, my mother came back, my father came back, my other brothers came back. And it was a very, very, very heavy feeling. And then 3 hours later, they came. My eldest brother was back home. They took him, and the fear started.
Jack.
Hi, thank you very much. Okay. Sorry, we've got a bit of a brain freeze. We weren't expecting to see my mother, late mother-in-law, Jacqueline Halaschi. She passed away a couple of years ago. You're okay, Bridget? Yeah, okay. I grew up exactly like Niran's, and there were schoolmates of mine with Niran and Edwin. We were very close to Edwin's family. They were in a group of friends of my father. We had an extended home, always open. There was a lot of bachelors, well-heeled bachelors, good businesses that didn't go with the big Tasqit or the big exodus to Israel. And they, a lot of them tend to gravitate in our house. I'd see them in Yom Tovs. We go to shul together. Most of them, unfortunately, were killed. The names are Shaul Rajwan, Yaqub Rajwan, the two brothers. Albert Nunu, Khduri Mukhtar, was killed in 76. When I opened my eyes, I was 11 in 67. But being a child in Iraq, it's not like our 11 years old. We had to grow very quickly. We didn't have a childhood. We had to be on the lookout. We had to be always on the defensive, especially when we're out with the general population. So my two maternal uncles were also there. My mother acted like mother hen to all the friends and my maternal uncles. They had a very successful press publishing business, very large premises. They married into families from Basra, two ladies. One, my uncle Yaakov married Rachel, the eldest daughter of the tragic, doomed Haskell family. So the family came to us and became a part of our extended household. There was a young boy, kicked a football with him, very nice, polite, always joked with him. He was 4 years older than me, that's Haskell. And their beautiful middle sister, Suad Haskell, who was only 2 years older than me. We were together all the time. They come for us for Shabbat and what have you. 67 war at all our world. We had the same life as Niran said. 67, our world went upside down, and menfolk arrested. My aunt Rachel was hysterical. Her brother, her 17-year-old now brother, was taken. Next thing we see is the trial, a sham trial. The first episode was done on TV live, and we see this young boy just look, his eyes didn't leave the floor. Obviously, they've been all tortured very badly. And still somebody had the guts to say, Anabari, Anabari, I'm innocent. Okay, so that taught them a lesson. The trial went off camera, and we end up listening all night long. My parents, it was on excerpts on the radio. It was more controlled. So anyway, it took them a month to, every night we stayed till 12 o'clock and we listen. And you know, I would listen with my parents. It's that kind of impression. And then despite pleas for clemency, that Black Monday morning on the 27th of January, they were called the people of Baghdad. 500,000, according to them, went around dancing and ululating and what Nadia just described. And there he was with a big placard, a jasus, the spy, Hesqel, a 17-year-old boy. They falsified his age to 20 in order so legally they can hang him. We didn't even go to visit him for Shiva. We sat, but my aunt Rachel was hysterical. It took a while for her to make some kind of recovery. Then our of the friends, we had a very close friend, Shaul Rajwan, and he was like our mentor. He would take us out every Sunday to picnics. He would, on the way back from picnics, he would teach us how to sing Shamsus Shamus. It's very apt that they did it. And when we get nearer, they say he'll say things like "Osanna lo baad baad shwele chab." People here will recognize these ditties. He was the one who taught me. I never knew, as you said, nobody was Zionism. We weren't told about Israel. I didn't know about Israel until Amu Shaul told me, or Uncle Saul taught me the story in his house one day. When I started asking awkward questions at 13 after the hangings, he turned around and he picked a book out of his library and he told me, I remember his word, we could have been 30 or 40 million, the Jews, if it wasn't for a man called Hitler. And the book he had in Baghdad then was the Diaries of Anne Frank. You know, so the man, my mentor, well turned around, people started escaping. And then, you know, I've got to say to you all, we are one of the luckiest generations of Jews in the last 2,000 years because we have Israel. Israel did the deal with the Iranians, with the Kurds, and I think more information will come with the Iraqis themselves, because we were watched mercilessly. People were at the end of every road. Reports had to be given. They knew exactly where we were at any point of time. And I don't think this escape would have happened had it not been happened without Israel's effect. Okay, sorry.
Right. No, that's okay. I just want Sharon to tell me what happened next, and then perhaps talk about, did you think about escaping? Why didn't you escape? Why did you wait?
So the only chapter that's different from most of the Iraqi communities in Iraq is that my father was Indian and we had Indian citizenship in Iraq. So they did take my brother, and my brother was taken right across the street from where we lived, and in a building that used to be the Baha'i temple. And that Baha'i temple turned into the headquarters of the security service. So my brother was there. And so my parents went to the Indian embassy, and they sought the help of the ambassador. And the embassy interfered. And within a week, my brother was released with a note: if your son does not leave immediately, next time we won't be able to do anything about it. And my brother left within 2 weeks. He came to Iran, and because he had the Indian passport, of course, he was able to fly at that time. And so he came to Iran with a lot of information about the state of the Jews in Iraq and the situation of Frangini, what's happening in Frangini, which he delivered to the Israeli embassy. Then from Israel, Iran, the Israeli embassy offered him to come to Israel, and he came to Israel for 6 months, and after that he decided to go to the States. And then we left about 4 or 5 months later, even without finishing school. We left Iraq and we went to Iran, and from there we went to Israel.
So, Jack, did your family think of leaving illegally through Kurdistan at any point?
No, my father had already opened. They closed him every time. He had a pharmacy. They took his license every time there was a war with Israel. And for the umpteenth time, they gave it back to him in 1970, so he opened another pharmacy. So we eventually left with passports. Basically, I had to leave a year earlier because we had an incident in Frangini where the Hitler Youth, one afternoon, Hitler Youth are the Baathist Student Union, we call them. They were basically hoodlums, 18-year-old with sidearms. They turned up, I think, in 1972. This is earliest after you were there, Sharon. They turned up one afternoon in our school, and they demanded 10 to 20 boys. Some boys ran away, but unfortunately, I was in class, and I was caught. They put us in buses, and we didn't know our fate. So they drove us to Sahte Tahrir, and I had to hold up placards and leaflets and shout, "Long live the Ba'ath Party," and all that. And they were, you know, they told us what to shout as well. And we had to walk in front, in the same place they hanged Hezgel. There was a platform, and Saddam Hussein was there looking at us. And I think somebody told him, and there was a smirk on his face. My parents went nuts. I mean, Hezgel were killed when he was 17, and this happened. So we had got passports, but my father was waiting to arrange affair. He sent me to London. They stayed and unfortunately witnessed the loss of Shah al-Rijwan. Suad Hezqel, the sister of Hezqel, was taken early, 73, with her husband disappeared. The Qashqush family, who were her husband's brother and his family, were machine gun murdered to death in their house, the whole family, the day after the Israeli raid on Lebanon. Then the penny dropped my dad. Then they took the passport and came to London. Thank you.
I'd like to ask you, Sharon, what you think of this commemorative day. Do you think it is having the impact that it should? Do you think it's a good thing? How should we make it have a bigger impact, if if you like.
I really think that this should be introduced to all the curriculum in all the schools, because to have communities in the Middle East and North Africa that survived more than 2,000 years, and then to be just expelled, I think it's a crime of historic dimension. And I think we should make more effort to bring this to the knowledge of people, because as you can see, the Palestinian cause, which is to me is not really a real cause if Israel did not exist, it's even made its way to the Mondial.
Mm-hmm. To the World Cup.
To the World Cup. I think it's imperative on us to follow up on this and to try to introduce it in the curriculums, especially in Israel, but also try to introduce it here.
And what do you think, Jack?
Yes, I echo this, what you're saying. We seem to have lost the battle of propaganda, the Palestinian side, and we should always, as Jews, have pity for anybody who is refugee. We should recognize the other side, but not the detriment of our side. It seems that the Palestinian story is told. Remember I remember a documentary by the cancer, that is the BBC, I call it the Bloody Broadcasting Corporation. An old Palestinian man, typical scene, all that switch, holding his keys to his old house in Yafo. These are the keys, and my children and my children's children will come and get it. We have a million keys. Why? How come you're not telling the same story? Where are they? We have a million keys. I've got the deeds of my uncle's massive print shop. Now it's apparently two blocks of offices in central Baghdad. Why isn't our story being told? We also have to learn from what happened to us, and especially important for what's happening now, because I'm living in Groundhog Day. What used to happen to us in Baghdad, we had days. We had the Balfour Day, the Quds Day, we had the Nakba Day, Six-Day War, we had Nakba Day, the Independence War, and marches always tended to end at the back gates of Frank Ahini, and they would be banking. That's all they were good at. All they were good at is hanging kids and scaring kids. We need to learn from that. This is now happening in the streets of London. We need to learn from that. And singing songs like Khaybar, Khaybar, Ya Yahud, you know, and what happened with the car convoy just in the traffic light just outside. We all need to do something. Thank you. Learn from our experiences. Thank you.
Just before I open up to questions, I just wanted to say something about this backdrop that you see here. This was actually designed by our Harif creative director, Michelle Huberman, what, about 10 years ago? Something like that. And this is actually the piece of paper that goes inside a mezuzah. So we have plastic mezuzot, you know, with this piece of paper, which actually tells you all the main points that you need to know about Jews from Arab countries. And you mentioned, you know, the property you lost, reckoned to be billions of dollars, and you too, presumably your family, lost everything. You know, this is something we need to do a reckoning of what was lost, and we need some sort of, you know, yeah, absolutely. Well, you need to have this just injustice somehow recognized and hopefully resolved. So just before, if anyone has any questions, please would they put their hands up? And I just want to call on your daughter, Emily, who I know is in the audience, to just, if I could ask her, what effect her mother's experience has had on her? I mean, has it shaped her in any way? Where are you, Emily? There you are, up there. Can you bring the microphone to Emily?
Hey. So I... I think now at this, being over 30, I really appreciate growing up with an Iraqi mother who experienced living in Iraq, leaving Iraq, and also just being the daughter of an Iraqi parent, growing up with, you know, amazing Iraqi food and beautiful Iraqi music and dancing and all the stuff we can connect about. And I also recognize that, especially because most people my age who are Iraqi Jewish, at this point it's their grandparents or great-grandparents who lived in Iraq. So for that reason, I really appreciate the more direct connection I have to her culture and history and family. And it also makes me reflect on, as the first generation being born outside of Iraq, what that means for us and how we can celebrate that, continue to educate other Jews and other people about Mizrahi Jews, and also preserve that for our kids and for the future.
Thank you very much, Emily. Are there any questions? Surely, yes.
Hi. Very quickly.
She's going first, right?
Who's going first?
Yes. Go ahead.
Okay. I get the impression that the Jews in Iraq were a bit exclusive, right? I'm wondering whether the community really did fit in with the Muslim population at the time, or whether you were just there because you were good at business. Can you tell us a bit about the Frank Eni school? Obviously, it's just an objective question, right?
It's true that the Jews, we had our Jewish school, we had our community club, sports club, where the Jews went there, and it was dominantly Jews. But we did mix with Muslims. We had Muslim neighbors. We worked with the Muslims. They invited us over. They came over to us. We invited them. I think there was a good interaction with the Muslim community, you know?
Now, we lived a paradox, you see. We wouldn't be here if we didn't get on with the Muslims. In the Farhud, the pogrom, I made sure I hear stories of all our elders for posterity. The neighbors, the Muslim neighbors, the people that were saved from the pogrom were by the Muslim neighbors. My family's my mother's family were saved by the Husseini, which is, it's a Shiite mosque. You see a lot of them now in Edgware Road and what have you. Across the road, standing guard and making sure nobody gets. We weren't exclusive. We had very good connection with them, very good friends. As you said, we had a lot of Muslim schoolmates at Frank Eni. Thank you.
I think it has to be said that in 1967 there were only about 3,000 Jews left, and all the kids tended to go to the same school, and of course created a very close bond with each other, which is still alive today. I can see it. You have school reunions, and it's something to behold.
I just wanted to say about the Farhud also, my family's, my parents, my grandparents, there was a mob that attacked many Jewish homes, and they killed and they looted. That did happen. But my grandparents' home, the neighbor came and he spread a prayer mat in front of the door, and he put a bottle of water next to him, which is part of the prayer. And when the mob came and broke the door, he said, "Anybody passes me will have to kill me first." And they left.
Yeah, there are many such stories like that. And actually, my father's parents were also saved by the Muslim neighbor. Can we have Jenny's question?
If the panel could respond to
what's been happening since the Abraham Accords were signed, because Lynn mentioned right at the beginning of the evening that no Jews wanted to go back to Iraq or the other countries that they were expelled from, but we're seeing the revival of Jewish life in Arab countries now, and I wondered what you thought about it.
Can I just answer that? I don't think you can speak of a revival of Jewish life in the UAE, because basically this is a new community. The UAE never had any Jews to start with. So this is an expatriate community. Yes, they are thriving, and long may it continue. I don't think you can speak of a revival even in the Moroccan community, because the people who are moving into Morocco now are either expatriates, they're people who want second homes, holiday homes, you know, French people who vacation in Morocco, and in fact even some English people we know have got second homes. So it's a completely different community, and they're not the sort who would perpetuate the traditions of the Moroccan Jewish community, in my opinion. Would you like to add something?
As to going back to Baghdad, they can keep it. I did go back to Erbil just after Iraq was liberated from Saddam, and God bless the Kurds, they saved us. Anybody deserves a country, they do. But I do argue a lot with... I was telling the lady from the Ifrat that I go on there. If anybody speaks Arabic, they should go on the Twitter feed of Afikha Ardai, the Arabic spokesman for the IDF. He's got 500,000 followers, maybe 0.01% are Jews who can speak and write and read Arabic, but all the rest are Arabs from all over and I interact a lot with them in the blogs, in the answer. He would say something like Jum'ah Mubarakah, Blessed Friday, and he'll get 200 insults, but he'll get good things from some Saudis, say thank you, he'll get lots of... I think they're not ready. The Arab world, from pictures I get, the Arab streets they call it, are not ready yet for us to go back to Iraq and that kind of thing. Thank you.
Thank you. Do you want to have a last word?
I just want to say that it's very, very much reinforced in the mosques, in the culture, in the daily culture, on TV, everywhere. We, the Jews, are the enemies. And unfortunately, this is not going to change anytime soon. As for me, whether I want to go back to Iraq, hell no. It was a miserable life for women to be there. Thank you.
So thank you very much indeed, Sharon. Thank you, Jack, for joining me. And thank you, JW3, for having us. Over to you.
Thank you so much to our panel. I'd like to invite Rabbi Dweck to the stage for some closing remarks.
Good evening. Thank you, Lynn Julius, Bea Lukowitz, Michael Uyghur, Efrat, and Michelle James. I want to thank you all for highlighting this evening by being here, by your stories, by your presence. My dear friends, היא שעמדה לאבותינו ולנו, שלא אחד בלבד, עמד עלינו לחלותינו, אל שכל דור ודור, עומדים עלינו לחלותינו, והקדוש ברוך הוא מצילנו מידם. That's the Halabi minhag of chanting the Haggadah. Shel Pesach. And the portion I just read translates that which stood for us and for our ancestors In every generation, they stand over us to destroy us. Not just one, but in every generation, they stand over us to destroy us. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu and the Almighty, the Holy One, saves us from their hands. And if that were not true, we of course would not be sitting here tonight. We would be destroyed. This is a poignant day. It's a day in which there is, in my experience, a confluence of joy and sadness. Sadness over the suffering, the loss, the leaving what was so dear. Every story, every experience, that's sadness. But there's also joy. There's joy in our identity and who we are. I don't know about you, but I hear the Oud and the Qanun. Halab, they say Anun. They don't pronounce the Qaf. They say Anun. I'm at home. The music consoles me. And I was born in Los Angeles. But it's my music. It's just as much my music as anybody in Halab or in Baghdad or in Cairo or in Lebanon. It's our music. One of the songs that they played, Abdul Wahab, I don't know the song, I mean, I know it now, but I didn't learn the song from listening to Abdul Wahab sing it. I learned it from Shahrit on Shabbat. That's how we sing it. It belongs to us. And here's what's important for us to remember. What will die there, and it will, maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, it will die there. What will die there will live in us and our people, because we are indestructible, and we have proven so. And so that opening line from the Haggadah that I quoted, that is really the truth. It is the Jewish story. It is the Jewish story told in every color, in every shape, and in every texture. But it is the Jewish story. And what lives in us is what carries on. And what we have taken out of these places. You know, you say, hell no, not going back there. Yeah, I get it. But it lives in us. And it always will. And Michael, you spoke about the fabric, and please God, it should be, and I appreciate you mentioning that, that the Board of Deputies is committed to weaving this into the fabric of our consciousness here in the UK, the Jewish consciousness. The reality is that it is the Jewish fabric. It is not, in terms of our own history, this is our fabric. This is the Jewish story. It is part of the Jewish tapestry. So for us on this day, we bow our heads in remembrance. But I believe at the close of this evening, at the close of this day, we must raise our heads in pride and in strength and in beauty and in song and celebrate us. For a long time, this aspect of the Jewish story, this aspect, the Arabic aspect, the Middle East, North African aspect, the volume on it has been turned down. And the volume of some of the other parts of our Jewish story have been turned up. And that's okay. Sometimes that happens in families. Different parts have different times in the light. We must turn this up. And thank you to Harif. And thank you to Sephardi Voices UK. And thank you to the Board of Deputies. And thank you for the Israeli Embassy. And thank you for the JLC. Thank you for turning the volume up. We must. And we must do it not just to tell our children, which we must do. We must do it in order to be able to shine the whole Jewish light, every aspect of its spectrum, in full. I deeply believe that in the face of all of the anti-Semitism that we experience in the world, and we are experiencing it today, there are things we can do to talk, to negotiate, to. There are many things we can do. There is one thing that I believe we must do. We must raise our heads high. We must be who we are. We must speak our names. We must tell our story. We must sing our songs. And we must do so to the best of our ability without fear. Because if anyone has a right to be on this earth, we certainly do. We've made it this far. We've made it this far with our hands tied behind our backs, burned by the fires of the world. And yet, here we are. Speak your name. Raise your head. Be who you are in the strongest, best, brightest way that you can. And please God, as it says at the end of that portion I just quoted, HaKadosh Baruch Hu Matzilenu Mi'adam, the Holy One, He holds us. So I close with thanks and blessings to all of Klal Yisrael, with all of their brightness and all of their story and all of their color. May the nation of Israel remain Chai V'Kayam. Good night.
Thank you to Rabbi Dweck. Thank you to Rabbi Dweck and all of our speakers from tonight. Before I say goodbye to you, I would just like to invite Michelle from Harif to come up.
Lovely, thank you very much. Well, first of all, before I pass on these little thank yous to our panel, I'd like to say a special thank you to Lynn Julius, our founder. Hang on. She's just celebrated her birthday 2 days ago, so big happy birthday, Lynn. It's from all of the Harif team. We all hold you in very high esteem. And also, it was very nice that campaign that we did for the mezuzah flashed up before. We actually did it 10 years ago. But it's interesting, it's really gone viral on the internet, on Twitter. Even this week, I don't know whether you received it as well, but I received from somebody in France that they were actually using that for their campaign in France. So I couldn't carry any more, but to give everybody who spoke one of these mezuzahs. So I'm going to pass them on. I couldn't carry them all, so I've got more. So thank you, everybody.
Michelle. And that concludes our evening. Thank you so much for joining us. I would like to invite you into our restaurant for a reception of Iraqi snacks. And it was lovely to see you all here and to all of you online. Thank you very much.